Okay, so last class we were looking at different reasons. What were those evolutionary forces, or what were those factors which are affecting the Hardy-Weinberg principle of equilibrium? Just to remind you about this principle speaks of how a particular genetic frequency or gene frequency or a genotype will keep changing in an evolving population. So that is what the Hardy-Weinberg principle of equilibrium talks about. And there were various factors which were affecting to this equilibrium, which is called as either evolutionary forces or the factors affecting the gene equilibrium. We had briefly looked at, or rather kind of revised, the genetic variation in population. What were those different factors? Reproductive isolation was another one that we like briefly saw, which means the different reproductive abilities of the population and how they cannot interbreed amongst different species. So that is reproductive isolation, which being one more evolutionary force. And then we had looked at this several right effect, or it's also called as genetic drift, which happens in the small population. And it specifically talks of how within a small population, the gene frequency, or what we call as allele frequency, has higher chance of fluctuations. So that was the several right effect. Now we will have a look at this, the what are the reasons because of which this genetic drift or the several right effects happens. So there were these two methods, sampling error or what we call as bottleneck phenomena, and the founder's effect. So these are the two reasons which are responsible for genetic drift or the several right effect. So let's have a look at the first one. Now the brief idea of this whole phenomena, you can visualize it from the diagram itself. You can see there are many colors over the time, which is the process of evolution. There are chance survivors, that means only few survive over the time, and that becomes a new population. So that's what is bottleneck effect. And like I said, bottleneck is kind of a barrier or kind of a hurdle, right? So neck is usually smaller than the whole bottle, and that's what is like kind of hurdle for going forward. And that's what is happening in this case. So like yearly or seasonal phenomena of cyclic fluctuation. Cyclic fluctuation means it keeps on happening after a certain period of time. In the population size, again of a different population size, it's very much observed in large varieties of individuals. So when there is a huge number of population, the smallest population size, not smallest, the smaller population size, which makes the larger population, they will have different variations, and that is that will be explained by this bottleneck effect. Now in such cases where the cyclic fluctuations are happening, the population crash leads to the extermination of majority of individuals. This is what is called as extermination. Like you can see from the colorful population, only a specific color is remaining. So this red is not there, or even green is not there. So that is like extermination of the majority of individuals, leaving only few to survive. That's what makes this chance survival. And these surviving individuals become the progenitor for the future generation. And these chance survivors, or these progenitors means the population which is responsible for future generation, that is progenitor. So that will cause this future generation. And this particular phenomena is called as population crash. It's literally like crashing from what it was original. It becomes chance survivor, and from there it goes to a different new population altogether. And this is associated with different phenomena that you know of as a natural calamity, or not being able to adapt to a particular situation. So that these are the different reasons, like simpler reasons I would say, for population crash to happen. So the population in the next generation will obviously increase dramatically, because it's always exponential or geometrical. and to undergo another population crash, but may lack some of the alleles because they are progenitors were without those alleles. So obviously from this blue and yellow population, they will completely remove or remove to greater extent all those alleles which are not required. And that's what the change in the population also occurs over the time. So that particular phenomena is involved in the population crash. Now such phenomena causing reduction in the allele frequencies, like you can see from red or green, that has been reduced. So that is like reduction in the allelic frequency and loss of some alleles from the gene pool. That was the gene population of the whole Mendelian population in a random fashion is called as bottleneck phenomena or genetic bottleneck. So in short, whole of this story, it's like you have different alleles which are exhibiting different phenotypes, and these are the alleles for one particular gene that we are talking of. Over the time, the cyclic fluctuations will occur, which will lead only to chance survivors. These chance survivors will become the progenitor for the next generation, and that will create the new population, which will not have all the earlier alleles which were present. And this is one way of looking at that genetic drift. Now, again, going back here a bit, where gene frequency or allele frequency exhibit great fluctuation. Now, so in this bottleneck effect, you can see the allelic frequency has changed from, like, obviously a particular allele's frequency is quite a lot. Like, for example, in the blue and yellow will have high frequency compared to the red and like green, which is almost negligible as in almost zero in this new population. So that is what is bottleneck phenomena, and this is explained with a bottleneck analogy. But in nature, if you relate it, this is obviously going to happen because these cyclic fluctuations, they keep on happening either in terms of adaptation, natural selection, or the natural calamities. So that is bottleneck effect. Any question here? Anyone? Okay. So I assume no questions are there. Then the second effect which leads to genetic drift or that several right effect is known as founder's principle, or it's also called as founder's effect. Founder literally means one who finds out something. That is what is founder, the same meaning. So the genetic drifts can produce again dramatic changes in the frequency of allele in a population that we already know of and derived from a few founder individual in the sense it's again the progenitor population from which the future generation comes out, and that enter a new or isolated geographical region, right? So this is a kind of example that they are giving here. You see, there is a whole lot of population and a certain population from this area. Now if you closely look at this diagram, the purple and red, they are almost equal, not exactly, but kind of. Now a certain population which is circled here will migrate. So migrating population will go and settle in a different geographical region. That's what we call as migration. And that when it will grow further, it will lead to a completely new population over the time, because certain alleles, they are bound to like either they due to the process of adaptation or again same reasons like we saw in the bottleneck effect, they tend to dissociate if they are not required, or they evolve or they change whatsoever, any of these reasons, the population will keep changing. So these founders, they carry only a limited portion of the parental gene pool, and the gene pool may be homozygous for certain character. Let's say if it was only red population which was moving from this whole pool, which is less in terms of like the possibility, it's usually a mix of population which goes and separate. But let's say if it is only red, then obviously the red will evolve. Or if it is only purple, then only purple will evolve. Or if it is mixed, certain population, depending on what are the environmental situation, what is the natural selection, what is the adaptation happening with this population in a differently located place, they will evolve into a different population altogether. So it means different founder colonies will possess different gene pools, which is quite obvious. Red will have, in this case, red will have red alleles, and the purple one will have purple alleles, and will soon become a different from each other and from the parental population. So these will separate amongst each other, plus they are also separating from the parent population, and such effect is called as founder's effect. So it is like literally a kind of theory which is being given forward, why that genetic drift or why there is change in the population keeps on happening as one of the force of evolution, or what we call as evolutionary force. So that is another factor. So these are the two factors, bottleneck effect and the founder's effect, responsible for genetic drift, which is one of the reasons for the evolution to happen, or evolutionary force. Again, any question here? Okay, so I assume again this part is clear. Now, what are those effects of genetic drift? Now, we saw that there are certain mechanisms through which this genetic drift can happen, either bottleneck effect or founder's effect. Now, what is the effect of this? It leads to the fixation of new mutation. Fixation of new mutation. Mutation does not necessarily mean it's a point mutation. It can be any change in the evolutionary aspect, right? So genetic drift will fix that particular alleles of the gene that arise by mutation from time to time. And that is when that becomes heritable over the time. So that is one effect that we see. Also, if you go back to this example, right, we know now this purple has completely evolved into only purple. So that has no other allele, let's say of red also. And if this is evolving, it will change it to something which will not have anything which is red. It will only have purple. So that is like change in the genotype and ultimately phenotype. So that is the fixation of the new mutation. Reduced variability. Again, this is genetic drift will produce genetic variability in the small population. And by this way, it eliminating one or two of the alleles, either by bottleneck effect or by founder's effect, or it can like either new or the old, like it can remove one of the two alleles, either new or old. It can remove whichever is upcoming new, it can remove that as well, or it can also remove the older alleles. But again, not necessarily it has to, but it can. That is the point. And thus eliminating the effect of genetic variation, which is called as decay of variability. So reduced variability within small population will ultimately drive that genotype of those individuals to be similar. And from there, it has more chance to get evolved further. So that is the decay of variability. So again, in the same aspect, like you might wonder, increase in variability ideally should increase the evolution. That can happen as well. But considering genetic drift specifically, a smaller population which has which creates this genetic drift and then ultimately giving rise to the genetic variability, in a small population, it has more chance to eliminate certain alleles because they are all same and they have adapted to certain situation or so on. And that way, the decay of variability, it can reduce as well. Then third one is the non-adaptive changes. Non-adaptive changes as well. So the genetic drift can introduce non-adaptive changes in the gene pool directly. So this is what we know as the actual mutation. Right, like let's say, for example, the effect of UV light on the human genome, right? That's not adaptation. That's happening in the genetic pool. And let's say if we are living in an area where there is a lot of these mutations happening, and if the mutations also happen to be in the germ cells that will obviously be passed on to the next generation. So these are non-adaptive changes. Maybe it is not required for adaptation process, but it happens in the environment. So these are the different effects of the genetic drift. Then, so again, I will go back a little so that we are all on the same point. So we looked at genetic variation as one of the evolutionary force, reproductive isolation, and the genetic drift. Now we are moving to the fourth point, that is natural selection, which is one of the very, very important evolutionary force, or one of the factors that affects that Hardy-Weinberg's principle of equilibrium of gene frequency. So in natural selection, and this is again a part of that neo-Darwinism, like coming from Darwinism, it's still being one of the factors in the neo-Darwinism, that natural selection operates only on large population. Genetic drift was more favorable for the small population. Reproductive isolation, again, for small population. And genetic variation can happen in any number of population. So that way, these are like little differences, subtle differences I use. So natural selection operates only on large population. And it is totally differential and non-random reproduction of the successive genotypes. Differential in the sense, like it happens differently for different organisms. It is not like, like if there are 10 different species, for all of them, the natural selection should happen in one particular. No, that is not the case. It is differential. That's why it is different, depending on whatever the needs of those organisms are. And it is non-random reproduction. So, like again, if we go back to that particular interbreeding phenomena of the reproduction, right? Within a particular species, let's say human species, this interbreeding or what we call as reproductive phenomena is quite common. So that way, this comparative reproductive success is higher. And that is one of the point on which natural selection occurs. It's a simple thing, like a very, you might find it a little weird that giving such example, but it's if a boy is very handsome, he always prefers a very beautiful girl. It's rare of the situation. Again, there might be exceptions and stuff, but that is like a general phenomenon. So something that exists in nature, like let's say the animal which is stronger, it will always try to find a stronger partner in whatever terms, right? So that is like the reproductive success in such cases is higher. So that way, this differential reproduction of genes or gene recombination means that those organisms which are best adapted for their environment, that is what is differential reproduction. That is when I said it happens differently for different organisms, because for a different organism, the environment where they survive or where they live, that will also be different. So that is when they are this differential reproduction talks of best adapted environment for that particular organism. And these organisms, they will obviously reproduce at higher rate, produce more offspring, and thus contribute to the more genes and the gene pool of the population. So this is pretty much logical, I suppose. The less adapted individuals, now on contrary, the less adapted individual will produce less number of offsprings, will contribute lesser number of genes to the total gene pool of the population. Now, if the differential reproduction continue for several generations, it's quite obvious the genes of those individuals, they will produce more and more offspring, will increase the number of gene pool, while the less adapted individual will be lagging behind in terms of their numbers and so on. And this will ultimately change the gene frequency in the population. What we are seeing in terms of founder's effect, how does it change? Obviously, certain population is together, they are bound to get attracted to the more closely related and more or rather best adapted individuals. they will meet or they will mate, they will produce offsprings, and such way the population will keep on increasing. Again, this is in sync with that survival of the fittest, like best adapted. That is what is the fitness meaning. So that is the process of natural selection that happens in the large population. There is this Khan Academy page, which I have cited here as a reference, a very well written, at least you should go and watch those videos on that topic, which explains pretty well and also a little bit more in detail. So, again, I have nothing else to say. This is something similar to the earlier diagrams that we had seen. So, parental generation, you can see there are variants, 1 has to 10. So, there is one black and 10% of the total population. Over the time, it will keep on increasing because it's one does not literally mean one, it's a percentage. Obviously, until and unless this black organism has a partner, it will not produce offspring. So the first offspring of that generation will have higher population. It goes on increasing. Ultimately, it becomes majority if that is best adapted to the situation. And that is how the differential reproduction happens in the process of natural selection. Any question so far? Okay, so then there are three different types of this natural selection. One is directional, then stabilizing, and disruptive. So we'll see one by one what these are. So directional selection, it literally means it is going in one particular direction. It produces a regular change in the gene pool of a particular population in one direction with respect to one or some specific character. Character can be one character, like let's say in terms of whenever the wings were developed across different species, there was only one character, but along with that character, when the bird has to fly, obviously the bone density has to change. Then there comes the another character. So that way the total evolution was changing a bit by bit, and that comes together either as one or more character, that is phenotypic character. So that is directional selection. That means natural selection is happening in one particular direction, and it is a progressive selection. Progressive means it goes on adding. That sets an evolutionary trend within the population. That means whatever the final target is, slowly that population start evolving in that particular direction, and that is seen in response to the directional changes either in the environment or some other factors for a long time. Like the example is industrial melanism in the case of Bison betularia. So this is a kind of peppered moth which started depositing pigments, melanin pigments, on the feeders. So that was happening over the time. So if you look at the pictures of evolution of this Bison betularia, you will see earlier the moth was more like a transparent. Then you will see a pigmentation, and then more pigmentation, and then complete black body. So that's like a peppered moth. And also in case of evolution of horse or man, you would have, if you remember the horse evolution we spoke of, from a grassland organism to a horse-like organism, and the change in the structure of the feet and the change in the structure of the toes and so on. So that's what happened in the horse. Also in case of man, you know, from apes to man, that particular transition was more directed in one particular direction. So that is called as directional selection. So if you look at the middle part, which is the directional selection, if you look at this particular diagram, you can see the larger individuals they are favored. So this is like a completely bell-shaped graph, because always there will be certain number which are extremities, and the majority of the population always falls in the terms of average characters, right? So that's why it is bell-shaped curve. And in this directional selection, any particular character that a particular organism or species or the population is directing towards, that will be on one of the sides, and that's when the larger individuals are favored. So that means this whole population is redirecting itself to become this as the majority, that whatever is the extreme. Yes,
by larger they mean the individual having more specific particular organ that they want to develop.
Yeah, it's any specific character, larger individual.
It's not like physically large, right?
Means they might have taken as an example of large individuals, but the curve or this diagram specifically talk, if you take any particular example, that population is moving in that direction. That is what it means to say. I don't know whosoever I picked up this diagram just to show as a pictorial, but this may or may not mean literally physically large. Yeah, but that is more specifically like what I want to convey from this diagram is this whole population will start evolving in this kind of population, which is extreme if you look at the larger population. But in terms of directional natural selection, it is heading into one particular direction. That means developing a certain specific character. Okay, so I also realized, like whatever you spoke in terms of body size, that's what they are showing it here. So this particular population, when they shift, now they don't have y-axis. Ideally they should have shown some numbers here, but if this was the size of the individuals, this peak would have shifted somewhere, right, in terms of the height of the peak from the x-axis. So again, I don't know what exactly they mean by peak shifts in one direction. Because if you look at both of these peaks, that doesn't make any sense. They both look similar to me. I don't see any difference. Neither I see any difference here as well, right? So it's number of individual with phenotype. So that way, I don't see any peak shift. The center is still here.
Maybe. But doesn't the arrow show to the right?
Sorry?
It is an arrow, right? In the middle diagram, the bottommost row, there's an arrow to the right, right? Like middle, that the is, middle diagram.
That is, huh?
Yeah, there's an arrow, right?
Correct.
So maybe with the arrow, they are saying they shifted to the right.
Huh, but then that is when I'm saying, like, if we know the numbers here, then we can say, obviously, like, let's say these are the extremely large individuals and their average compared to this average will surely be higher if these are all large individuals.
So this graph is like for something like the elephant, the bigger, the better.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, but I would still discard the lower part, right? Discard in the sense, or we put some numbers here. Let's say it is 1, 2, whatever number, right? Quite a lot of numbers, and then we are choosing only larger individuals, and let's say this was like 10, 20, 30, 40, and then 10 would start from here, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, and 100 maybe. So the average at let's say 50 or so will be here, right? I hope you are able to get what I'm trying to say. But yeah, anyway, so main point that we need to know from the directional selection is that the whole of the population will try to shift based on the adaptable environment. They will try to shift the whole population in terms of one specific direction which has certain specific characters. It can be one characteristic or can be more. Then the second one is stabilizing selection. Natural selection can also happen in the stabilizing way. So in this type of selection, it will favors the average or normal phenotype and eliminate the extreme variants. It's a simple mechanism. Like in some cases, you have different range of particles. Now I'm giving an analogical situation. not the living things as such. And you filter out the smaller particles, you filter out the bigger particles, what you get is the average population. So in nature also, something like that happens. The extremes, they get eliminated, and it occurs in a constant environment and eliminates the new mutation. So because the new mutations, they are getting eliminated every now and then. And this is again a natural process by different means. And also, if the environment is constant, if there is no changing environment, obviously the individuals, they try to remain as they were, and they maintain more of the average or normal phenotypes. If the situation changes, obviously they will shift in one particular direction or maybe two particular directions. So that is what? Yes.
Does this happen in humans?
Humans, we are not sure, because again, in humans, it was more like a directional selection, like I said.
No, right now, like currently. Like we have to undergo some form of natural selection. We can't be free from natural selection.
Actually, quite possibly. But then, if you think in terms of environment, we are facing the issue of global warming. So I wouldn't say like maybe our generation, like from last 100 year to next 100 year, this 200 year, we may not see much changes, right? But over the time, if you look at 1000 year gap, 1000 years period, not the gap, you might see certain changes, but for that, we won't be there. But yeah, so that way...
If we see that way, then it'll be directional, because our brains are getting bigger.
Yeah, in a way, yes.
Okay. So that means we aren't living in a stable environment.
Yeah, we are not. Clearly, we are not. But let's say, for example...
So, but by like if you see our daily life, for most of us, like... Isn't it pretty stable? I mean, every day we are doing the same thing. There's no natural calamity. There's no lack of food. Like there's nothing, there's no change externally.
It's a very short period of time. No, not even short. It's a very negligible period of time compared to the period of evolution.
Yes, that's there. But the change has to be there, right? Still, at least.
But the, that being said, the change...
You're saying that the change is not like in a span of 100 years. Maybe the change happens every 500 years or something.
Yeah, and that change we are seeing even within our generation. Maybe you remember probably in your childhood, the temperature, the rain, and these fluctuations, they were more, they were less. Now it is more. That's like obvious environmental change. And we don't know where it is taking us as of now. So these changes are happening. It just... When we look at from a very broader perspective, then only we will understand it. But obviously, we have seen that particular change happening in the human being. Like at least for the past 2000 years. So, in this destabilizing selection, the environment is more constant and it will keep eliminating the extremes of the mutation. And that way, it will keep stabilizing the average population, and it always favors the homozygosity without changing the mean value. Homozygosity means a particular type of trait or character always being favored because the environment is constant, and that way something that is extreme which will not be favored and that will get eliminated. That's a simpler law. So this is a kind of stabilizing population. So if you look at this central population, which is shown in white, that is favored. And these extremes, they are removed. And that is when the peak becomes more like a stout peak. That's what is being shown here. So because that population will increase, the extremes will go up. So that is the stabilizing one. And the next one is the disrupting, or what is also called as diversifying selection. Now in this specifically, the selection acts to break up the previous homogeneous population into two or more population. So a particular type of evolution due to different situation can take different adaptation, can take different adaptive norms. And it will favor start favoring the individuals at both the extremes. Extremes in the sense, again, It need not be literally extreme. It can be changed environments, and that becomes their routine environment. So that is what is extreme meaning here of the distribution curve. And as a result, the two peaks in distribution traits are produced. So for example, whatever is being shown in this particular figure, you can see that this was the original curve. Obviously, these extremes, large and small individuals, they are favored. The extremes are favored. They try to develop their population larger in the sense that they adapt to the best possible way, and they create more population, and that way they create this two curve. And again, this two is just an example here. It can be three curve or four curve, depending on how many different forms are evolving or how many different types of adaptation and then leading to different species there. So that is the disruptive selection. So these are three different types of selection: directional, in one particular direction, stabilizing, favoring more of the average population, and disruptive, that is favoring more of the extreme population. So that is, these are the three different types of natural selection. Any question here so far? Okay. I don't know why I have kept it here. Must be I have forgotten to mention it earlier. But this you would know already, what we refer to biological species, which is a group of organisms that can potentially interbreed or mate with one another to produce viable or fertile offspring. That's what the biological species is.
But like nowadays, different species can also do that, right?
Sorry, different species can also?
Like different species can also do that, right? Like produce fertile offsprings. So shouldn't they change the definition or something?
What do you mean by that? If you are talking about mule or dodzenki and stuff?
No, sir. Like, I actually saw a video and they were explaining about hybrids, and they said actually a lot of hybrids can actually reproduce. A lot of them can't, but a lot of them can.
If we talk specifically in terms of plants, plant hybrids specifically.
No, sir. Animals, like they give examples also, like proper animals, like liger and all that. So the females can reproduce, the males can't. So, and in some both can and stuff like that.
That is true. That can happen as well. But also we need to...
This is a general trait, not like one specific reproductive individual, like generally.
But then is it happening naturally or is it artificial? That is also something that we need to see. I doubt naturally it is happening, right?
Or
it might happen in rare of the cases.
They reproduced it, like they did it artificially. No, sir, actually one type of bear, that's a hybrid. It's found in the wild, though it's rare.
Okay.
But most of the examples, they were artificial, but they were normal, so they could reproduce. And they could reproduce among themselves, or they could reproduce among the parent species, or one of the parent species.
So in some cases, yes, it is quite possible. But again, it goes back to the same fact of number of chromosomes, the viability, the reproduction ability, the reproduction types, all of these, how is the organism surviving, right? In terms of offspring, how is that offspring being grown in the mother's body, or whatsoever those conditions are. There will be few exceptions always, but at large, if we look, this definition is true for most of these species. And the interbreeding, whatever we are talking of, it's very, very less. It's like almost, again, less than 0.1% of the whole population, which is like nothing. And also, So when these species will start interbreeding, that means across the species, what we know of as liger, zinke, mule, and so on, and if they start becoming fertile, due to the, let's say, chromosomal changes or due to the adaptation or whatsoever reason, if they start becoming more fertile, obviously that is one part of evolution, right? Because there must be certain reasons that these organisms, they are changing over the time. So there are always certain factors which leads to this, and in that case we can call that particular species as a biological species. But as of now, still this is the case. You might know that different species of the dogs also, they can interbreed very well, right? And these are different species altogether. So that way, the definition has certain clauses for sure.
Okay.
So there are again different examples that are mentioned in your textbook. So I won't go into them because you can just simply read them. Industrial melanism, I already spoke in terms of that peppered moth, how the pigmentation started happening over the time. That is the one of the phenomena. Resistance to pesticides in insects. Again, because of the adapted situation, most of the insects, they have developed resistance to the pesticides. Similarly, there is antibiotic resistance in the bacteria. Certain bacteria, they have synthesized particular enzymes which degrades the bacteria. So, for example, this penicillin resistant bacteria which have developed, penicillin structure contains beta-lactamase, which is a typical structure in terms of organic chemistry. And this penicillin resistant bacteria, what they developed was the beta-lactamase. So that enzyme used to degrade the basic framework of that penicillin antibiotic. So that antibiotic was no more active against those bacteria. So these are like natural processes that can happen within different species. Also related to this antibiotic resistance, I must say, like, if we take unnecessary antibiotics and if the large population takes unnecessary antibiotic, this is going to lead or give rise to many bacterial species which are resistant to those antibiotics. And that is when you would have heard earlier a particular drug which was more effective for a particular condition, let's say malaria, flu or whatsoever, is now no more active at all, or is active against a very specific strain of bacteria. And that is because of this antibiotic resistance.
So, but isn't it possible to create a drug that you can't become immune to, like, naturally? Because there are limitations what biology can do, right? Like inside the human body. But artificially, chemically, like in labs, we can even make compounds that through the normal processes can't be made. So in extreme conditions, like, or pressure or something like that, some structures that will form, like intermediates that are very unstable, that can't normally form, we can make that in labs and we use them. So, like, is that possible?
That happens. So same in case of ampicillin, which, or rather penicillin, that was the drug which gets degraded by this beta-lactamase enzyme. So what many researchers did was, they changed the beta-lactam ring in a such a way that they are not changing the molecular three-dimensional structure, but they are just changing the outside loop. So that due to either steric hindrance or whatsoever reason, the beta-lactamase enzyme is not able to degrade that beta-lactam ring in the structure. So that way, the antibiotic resistance was gone in certain derivatives. So that's when you have this ampicillin, amoxicillin, and so on. There are different derivatives of penicillin.
Like, through time, like in time, if bacteria gets enough exposure, it can potentially make something that counters that, right?
Yes, correct. And that is when I say, when a large population unnecessarily starts taking these antibiotics, this is bound to happen because it's a natural process ultimately to adapt.
So rather than these temporary measures, can't we make a permanent type of drug that, like, biologically you can't grow resistant to, like, you can't produce that its counter, in the human body or something like not in the human body, in the organism's body.
See, that's what is always a try, but that's when I say, because it's a natural process of adaptation of certain organisms, they will try to tackle it as and when possible, right? It's the same thing. Like, we know that we are not able to tolerate like extremes of cold or extremes of hot weather, but we still try to adapt to such situations. So it's something similar. Over the time, even these bacteria, they will, like, even if you say that I'm going to develop the best possible drug or antibiotic, which will act against most of the organism, plus it will have no resistance. Maybe at this time it is true. Maybe for next 100 years it will be true. But over the time, if you look at, and if it is continued being used, this particular, it may or may not, I'm not saying it will, but it may or may not develop that resistance. Like, the bacteria may or may not develop the resistance against this antibiotic. So that is a natural process. There we can't say. So whenever, another thing I must say, like, whenever a scientist develop a particular drug molecule, they think of all these possibilities. They might have certain drugs which is excellent, but then that delivery in the sense that particular drug needs to be delivered to the human body so that that infection can be stopped. That becomes another critical parameter. The toxicity becomes another critical parameter. So if that particular molecule, if it fits into all this category, if it is proven right, then only it will become a good medicine. Otherwise, it is just like very, very resistant, but being toxic also at the same time, or very, very resistant, but cannot be delivered to human body. And when it is delivered, it degrades. So, like, there are so many like drawbacks in such processes. So, but still, people try to develop as best molecule as possible. So that is the antibiotic resistance.
So we can't predict the limit to what chemicals a bacteria or some other organism can produce over time.
Yes, we can't really predict it at times. Like, again, these studies, future predictions or simulations, they can be done. But again, that's still a prediction, right? It's not really a foolproof experiment that we can do. Okay, this is what it is not going to happen. That we can't say literally. Ultimately, it's a living system and it's an adapting system.
Yes, sir.
Right. And then there are these other examples. Sickle cell anemia is one of the example of natural selection. Again, you can read, it's a change in the hemoglobin structure, and because of it, sickle cell anemia occurs. And there are individuals of three phenotypes usually, one with normal phenotype, one with sickle cell anemia type. That means both the alleles are affected. And the third one, which has half normal allele, which is getting expressed, and half sickle cell anemia allele getting expressed. So you can just read about it. It's a simpler thing. And the another example is malaria in relation to this G6PD, that is glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency. So there is certain relation between the individuals which has this deficiency, how prone they are to malaria-like situation. Again, that's another simpler example of the natural selection. You can go through them on your own. Okay, let me finish this small part. So there is something called as polymorphism, which is in connection to the natural selection. So it simply means presence of variety of phenotypes. And again, this we had seen earlier, presence of variety of phenotypes as well as genotypes in a large population of many habitat, and each one adapted to particular habitat. Such a population is called as polymorphic population. In short, like let's say we are living in Indian territory, someone is living in a cold territory, like let's say people from Canada or Russia and so on, people from very tropical countries like Australia and so, or hot temperate situations. And so there are different habitats. So that way, the phenotypes, we know the skin color being one of the phenotypes, is drastically different. Genotypes, they are also different. Caucasian population has a different genotype. African population has a different genotype. Obviously, there is similarity to larger extent, but certain alleles or certain genes, they do differ. And that is what talks of this polymorphism, and the population with which in which this polymorphism exists, that is polymorphic population. At the end, all the Mendelian population, that means the one which is interbreeding amongst each other, that is the Mendelian population, they are polymorphic, because there will be certain changes in the genotype and which will lead to the phenotypic changes. And because almost all these gene loci, they are at least represented by two alleles. Like one particular gene always has two alleles, minimum two alleles. It can have more, of course, like skin color, hair color, eye color. They have more than two alleles that we know of. So that way they are surely polymorphic. Or you take any other gene, which will always have dominant or recessive. These are at least two different alleles, or both dominant or both recessive. That is still two different alleles. So that way, one particular gene having two different alleles in a Mendelian population makes it all these Mendelian population a polymorphic population. That means having more than one particular genotype and phenotype. So that's it for today. I'll stop here. There is very small topic left out, artificial selection and the speciation part, which we'll see in the next class. And then adaptive and convergence and divergence. That's it. And I will just briefly discuss about the evolution of the human being. And that's it. We will be done tomorrow with this chapter. So like I had planned, we are on track. If at all you want to discuss something more from this topic, you let me know. We can do it tomorrow.